In this section, we're going to cover RF interference measurements, EMC pre-compliance testing, signal strength and site survey measurements, as well as recording and monitoring the RF spectrum for security surveillance, defense SIGMON, satellite signal monitoring, and intruder watch. It's worth pointing out again that the internal battery lasts 3 to 4 hours, but if you're driving around in a vehicle making site survey measurements, then you can run the unit indefinitely from the vehicle's cigarette lighter socket with the appropriate accessory cable. You'll see I've switched over to the 20 GHz model, the N9344C. I thought it would be good to see how well these analyzers perform up in the microwave bands, but be aware that all the features that we cover in this section are available on all models in the range. You'll also see I've turned on the built-in GPS receiver. Here you can see our current position, expressed as lat and long, and this can be saved with every measurement we make. Now, depending on your field of interest, you may decide to use a close-field EMC probe, such as one of the Agilent 11940 series probes for EMC pre-compliance measurements, or perhaps a broadband log periodic antenna, such as this, covering 380 MHz to 18 GHz, or even a cheap whip antenna, such as the one we've been using for other demonstrations on the video. But before we start connecting antennas, let's take a quick look at the sensitivity and sweep time of the analyzer. Spectrum analyzer sensitivity, the instrument's ability to detect weak signals, is vital when we're trying to perform these kinds of tasks. And sweep time is equally important if we're trying to catch signals that are both weak and intermittent. So I'll disconnect the antenna and connect a 50 ohm termination to the input. I'll press instrument preset. And let's select a frequency of, say, 14 GHz, which is a common frequency used in digital microwave links. I'll set a span of 1 kHz. And let's press the amplitude button. We'll set the attenuation to 0 dB. We'll turn the preamplifier on. And let's adjust the reference level to bring the trace back up onto the screen. I'll press the trace button and press more, and we'll turn averaging on, and I'll turn on a marker. And you can see here we've got a displayed average noise level or sensitivity of around minus 147 dBm. Let's just change the frequency to 18 GHz and see what we get there. And once the averaging has settled, and you can see here, at a frequency of 18 GHz, we're still getting a sensitivity of around minus 144, minus 145 dBm. Quite incredible for a handheld spectrum analyzer. It's all very well having great sensitivity, but some handheld spectrum analyzers out there in the market have gained a reputation for generating quite a lot of RF noise and interference themselves. Hardly ideal when trying to detect weak signals in a radio quiet, secure environment, or when trying to remain undetected yourself. But you'll be pleased to discover that Agilent's handheld spectrum analyzers are incredibly quiet. The RF shielding is simply outstanding for a handheld unit. One feature you may wish to use when using antennas or probes is to set the Y-axis units to microvolts, or dB microvolts, depending on your particular application. Currently, you can see the marker is measuring in dBm, the scale on the y-axis is in dBm, but if I press the amplitude button and select y-axis units, you'll see I've currently got dBm selected, but we can also select dB millivolts, dB microvolts, watts, volts, and if I press more, we can even select dB microvolts, EMF. And if you're using a calibrated antenna or probe that comes with a table of antenna factors, such as this close field probe or the log periodic antenna I have here, you can even enter these antenna factors into a table that's held inside the analyzer and therefore get calibrated measurements of field strength in microvolts per meter or dB microvolts per meter. I simply press return, press more, press correction. And here you can see a range of correction factor tables can be stored, which we can turn on, and then turn on the antenna units to display in true field strength. So let's start by looking for some weak signals in the 430 meg ISM band. So I'll press frequency and enter a frequency of 437 megahertz and a span of, say, 10 megahertz. And to increase the sensitivity, I'll press the amplitude button reduce the attenuation to 0 dB. I'll turn the preamplifier on. And you can see now we have a range of signals here being picked up by this antenna. There seems to be some kind of spread spectrum signal here. A few modulated carriers maybe, or carriers anyway. And I noticed over here, there we go. There's an intermittent signal popping up and down every now and then over here, of various amplitude levels. So let's go through the various steps to see how we would characterize and measure and maybe even record these signals. First, I'll press the marker button. And I'll go shift peak. And that tells me the amplitude and frequency of the highest signal on the display. But let's press the marker button again and turn on some other markers. I'll turn on marker 2. And let's move that marker to the peak of one of the other signals here. In fact, let's turn on a couple more markers. Marker 3. Set it to normal. And you can now see we've got three markers turned on. And if I press return and press marker table on, you'll now see we have the three markers listed at the bottom of the screen with their x-axis, their value, their frequency, and their amplitude in dBm. I'll turn that off. Now, how are we going to capture this very intermittent signal over here? Well, there's a couple of ways we can do it. The first thing I'm going to do is press the trace button. You'll see currently we're looking at trace 1, which is the yellow trace on the screen. And that's set to the mode called clear write. In other words, it clears the screen, writes a new trace. Clears the screen and writes a new trace. I'll go to trace 2, and that's currently set to blank. But if I turn on max hold, you'll see this blue or turquoise colored trace here now is storing the maximum amplitude value seen for every frequency point on the display. So the constant signals like these ones here, the trace there looks pretty much the same as the yellow trace. But for this intermittent signal over here, you'll see that it holds that value. So max hold is a very simple and quick way of identifying, are there any intermittent signals on the spectrum? Just as an aside, I can turn on trace 3 and set that to min hold. And that will now show us the minimum amplitude value that the analyzer has seen for every frequency point on the trace. I'll turn that back off. So max hold is a great way to identify intermittent signals. It tells us that since we turned on max hold, an intermittent signal has occurred. But what it doesn't tell us is when that signal occurred. So if we were to leave this analyzer set here now for a few hours and I come back, I wouldn't have any idea as to how frequent that intermittent signal is. And that's where the spectrogram feature on these handheld analyzers is invaluable. If I press the Mesh button and press Spectrum Monitor, you'll see the display has been divided into two sections. The bottom half is still showing a live spectrum analyzer trace, the yellow clear write trace that we saw previously. But the top half of the display is now showing a spectrogram. The x-axis is still showing frequency, but the y-axis is now displaying time. In fact, the amplitude of the signal is now displayed by the color of the trace. A strong signal is displayed as yellow or red, and a weak signal is shown as blue or green. We can easily adjust the colors of this. If I just press the amplitude button, and let's set the scale per division to 5 dB per division, and then I'll change the reference level. You'll see now much more clearly we have a very strong carrier here shown in the red, some slightly weaker carriers here in yellow, even weaker ones in green, and then there's a little intermittent signal, quite strong, so it's in red. And you can see now how often that intermittent signal is transmitting. If I press the Mesh button, you'll see here we can pause and run the spectrogram. We can restart the measurement, clearing all the traces that we've stored in the internal memory. And we can even set the update interval, currently set to 100 milliseconds, but let's say I wanted only to record a new trace every 10 seconds, for example. I could type in 10 seconds for that, and now the instrument will pause for 10 seconds and then add a new measurement to that stack of traces in the spectrogram display. I'll set the update interval back to its fastest, 100 milliseconds. We can set the display mode so that it's just showing the spectrogram or just showing the trace. or, my preference, displaying both. Now here's probably the most useful feature of the spectrogram measurement, and that's file logging. So if I press file logging, and I press start save, every trace now is being stored into the internal memory of the analyzer. And we're going to be able to play that back later and analyze what happened while we were away. In fact, for example, if you wanted to set the analyzer up to only record during the night, starting say at 10 o'clock at night and finishing at 2 a.m. in the morning, we can set the time setting here, set times save on. You can enter the start date and start time and stop date and stop time, and the analyzer will automatically start logging at a predefined time and stop at a predefined time. This is ideal for unattended logging, as it means we can leave the analyzer out on site, return a few days later, and then view what happened during that period. I'll press return. If I now press stop save and press shift file, and let's view trace data, you'll see here the TRC, the trace file, that the unit has stored for the spectrogram logging. Here, stored at 20 past 10 in the morning on the 23rd of April. So if I scroll down to that and press recall, now I've called back onto the screen the entire spectrogram trace log that we've just recorded. Now what's especially good when it comes to analyzing the spectrogram trace is how the markers work. So I'll press marker, and marker one is currently turned on. I'll press marker two and turn that marker on. And you'll see here we can adjust the frequency. So if I press frequency and turn the knob, you'll see marker 2 here on the lower trace, but you'll also see a white cross on the spectrogram trace. And not only can we move that white cross across the trace and look at the amplitude values for particular frequencies, but you'll notice that the M2 marker also has a display at the bottom saying M2 time. So the current trace we're looking at was the trace stored at 10, 17, and 57 seconds. If I press the time button, we can then wind back in time. In fact, here you can see at this time, at 10, 17, and 54 seconds, you'll see that the intermittent signal occurred at that point in time. So the lower trace in the turquoise color is showing the specific trace record from the spectrogram. And we can see the frequency, the amplitude, and the time at which that signal occurred. This is an amazing capability to be able to do this in a handheld spectrum analyzer, logging so much information without any need for a PC or other storage device. It's all being done internally within the Agilent HSA handheld spectrum analyzers. And best of all, if we were using this in a site survey or drive test situation where we were mobile in a vehicle, monitoring, for example, and recording the signal strength of various repeater sites, the GPS position information is also stored with each record in the spectrogram. So not only can we tell the frequency and the amplitude that each signal was, but also the signal strength at each geographic location as we drive around. If you'd like further information on these products, including demonstration guides, operating manuals, or application notes, please visit the website shown below.